And this is the exterior mold of the upper mandible taken from another crow of the same age and size, so that we can have this for the prep work that is needed before we attach the actual prosthesis. The underside of the boot. This is going to be the bite for you. Right here in the beak, it was growing upward in like a little horn. And so that's been taken off because that's not helpful, is it? And the acrylic will actually allow, it will train the beak to grow in the right direction and not to go rogue. And so as it's growing out, it will be backfilled and reshaped so that it constantly fits her bite and is aligned perfectly with the lower mandible, even as it grows. It will take quite a long time for it to grow out, but she will require regular maintenance every couple of months. Right, so a little reshaping right here, a little smoothing here, and then the black acrylic to go over. It's not merely for aesthetics, it's also for the sake that we don't want other birds picking on him whilst he's at school, do we? Want him to look the same, and corvids are very curious, and we don't want them picking at his beak if it's a different colour than theirs. And that, my friends, is how you successfully restore a beak. This is a successful beak reconstruction. Now, as the beak grows out, the part that's naturally there, here, it will grow out, and as it's growing out, this shape will maintain, obviously. So it will have to be refiled and shaped right here and slightly trimmed as it grows out until it's entirely his own character and his natural beak. So other than maintenance, it's fully functional even now. He can pick up things he's already bitten me, which is about the best endorsement I could get. Sweet little glory.
Is that so good? Is that good? Wow.
Hello everyone, we just finished the latest beak prosthesis procedure, and it was successful, thank goodness. The question has been raised several times as to why we're not implementing the new technology in terms of what is available with 3D printing. Really quickly, I'm just going to address that. I realize it's one of those things that when you hear it, it sounds like, well, of course, doesn't that sound like the most logical thing is to use the newest technology? However, as so many things are, the reality versus the dream don't quite match up. And so the reason we use this, the same reason we've used this for dozens of years and with I don't even know how many birds, and successfully every single time, is because there are major components that we look for in material. We're still very open-minded. Hopefully one day even a better material will be made, and we're all for that. But for the time being, it's still the best in terms of the seal that actually occurs. For instance, if it's the upper mandible that it has been destroyed or partially destroyed on a bird, with proper preparation, proper sanitizing and all of that good stuff, the seal is remarkable and is permanent or semi-permanent. And that's something you can't achieve with a 3D printed object. The other thing is that it's lightweight. It's very lightweight. Now, 3D printing can possibly, and sometimes is, actually even lighter weight than the acrylic, which is something we really look for, obviously. I mean, that's the whole reason that birds traded in teeth, isn't it? So they would have the lighter weight beak instead. However, and that's not quite enough for us to make the leap to go in that direction. If we were well funded and everything was fine and we had all the money to do whatever we needed to do and outfit our surgeries the way we would like, would we purchase a good quality 3D printer for this reason? No, absolutely we would not. And the reason is because the seal is one, as I've just mentioned, it's an airtight seal, and as the bird's beak grows out, there is yet another dimension of acrylic that makes it extremely appealing to this particular kind of reconstructive work. And that is the ability to infill and to maintain it. So as the beak grows out over time, it can be refiled to fit the shape as it's meant to be growing more narrow. It grows out the same as it is, and that can be reshaped. And so it only eventually will get smaller and smaller until the entirety of the keratin in the bird's beak has entirely replaced that one prosthesis. So this kind of flexibility and the sealant quality of this kind of a prosthetic is amazing, and it's something we've not been able to find anywhere else. So the sealing is part of it. If you have a 3D printed beak, you have to attach it with things like wires or other kinds of apparatus that can cause stress fractures and other problems that can otherwise compromise the integrity of what is left of the beak to work with. Whereas we use a puzzle piece technique, and so that even if a bird is a heavy pecker, he really pecks hard and he uses his beak very, very aggressively, whether it's toward food or in self-defense or whatever, this process can withstand that kind of stress, and it can also immediately dissipate all of that pressure throughout the sealing area of the prosthetic. And in that way, it makes it last much longer, it's a lot more reliable. And we've had prosthetic that grew out over the course of an entire year, no problems whatsoever. Again, just refiled and reshaped every 8 weeks or so, depending upon how fast the beak grows for the bird that's been treated. Obviously, this is our favorite technique for a hard-billed bird. If you have something like a soft bill, you know, a toucan, for instance, that's an entirely different process, and we actually prefer things like fiberglass, but that's another subject. So anyway, the seal is important. The fact that it's essentially permanent but grows with the bird, that's brilliant. We're quite happy with that. The lightweight yet strength of the material is fantastic. And I suppose for me, one of the biggest issues is the fact that with a 3D printer, you have to do many tries, put under several sessions, and more often than not, they tend to fail within 2 weeks. They tend to break away from the bird's face, partly come away, or some other problem, and they can cost up to tens of thousands of pounds, depending upon how many people you have involved in coming together to design this apparatus. And whereas our whole procedure never takes more than an hour and 45 minutes of the bird actually being in hand. The whole thing, the prosthetic molding and all that, may take longer, but the bird actually being held and worked with is never more than an hour and 40 minutes. And there are, of course, many breaks in there anyway, so the bird is relaxed and isn't stressed out. So that's why we prefer this. And the other reason is my strongest objection is if you look at the data for the various species, avian species, and how they react to general anesthesia, especially if you have to put them under several times, multiple times for various fittings, not an acceptable risk to our minds. It's contrary to what we stand for here
It's just something we're not comfortable with, and especially when the birds tolerate it so very well and have never had an adverse reaction whilst being fitted for the prosthetic. So those are our reasons. As I said, I know it does have a lovely appeal, does it not, especially to technophiles, and it is promising for the future, but for the now, I'm afraid it's definitely going to stay with the gels and acrylics that have been approved for human use. This is definitely our forte and our product of choice. So I hope you enjoy the video. I hope you enjoy watching this bird recover a new and exciting life and be able to actually use her beak as she was meant to. So very important, because it's for preening, it's for eating, it's for everything. And you'll notice that the colour is almost identical to the lower mandible. The reason is because we applied a coloured acrylic over it in order to mimic the natural colour that would be in the pigment of the natural beak. We didn't do this really for people, we really did this because we don't want her, you know how playmates can often pick on the other children that are not quite like they are. If you have a crow coming out with a bright white beak, that's not a good idea to introduce her to new corvids. So in this way she fits in beautifully and they don't think anything about it because it looks just like them. So anyway, enjoy, and thank you for visiting yet another Blue Highlands reconstruction. Cheers.